All right, so let's, my wife, sorry, as you can see, is not here with me, but I have a Finnish flag as a bookmark in my Bible. My wife is from Finland. And so she'll be here in September for a little while. Maybe some of you will get to see her. Anyway, so I'm going to read a little bit from 2 Samuel chapter 9 in a moment. And I want to talk about, in this story that we're going to read, I'm going to give you some historical backdrop to it. 2 Samuel chapter 9. And I want to talk about the subject of hiding. And this guy in this story is a man who lived his life in hiding. You know, we've all played hide and seek as kids, right? It's a simple game. Every kid plays it and loves it. I was talking to somebody the other day about how kids, you know how they hide behind their hands and think because they can't see you, that you can't see them, all that kind of thing. Okay, so that's going to be relevant to this story. I want to talk about hiding. And this guy in this story lived his whole life hiding somewhere. And this guy in this story, his name, wait for it, good old-fashioned Old Testament name, Mephibosheth. Anybody ever heard of Mephibosheth before? Tim has heard of him. Okay, the pastor's in the house. They're the only people who know. Mephibosheth. I mean, who goes around talking about this guy? I'm sure I'm going to say it wrong if I keep using his name. But Mephibosheth, you're going to be familiar with his family. Mephibosheth was the son of Jonathan. And Jonathan was, remember, the best friend of King David. David, as we know, is the most popular, arguably, and maybe Solomon, but David, in my mind at least, is the most popular, most renowned king, at least, of Israel. And David took on the kingship around about 1,000 years B.C., before Christ. So he has a best friend called Jonathan, and Jonathan's son is called Mephibosheth. Well, what's interesting about this story is that we're going to pick it up right after a few things have happened. There's a sequence of events where Mephibosheth's grandfather, King Saul, who we know him as well, right? The guy who hunted David, the guy that tried many times to kill him. I couldn't quite figure out exactly from history how long Saul hunted David, but it was somewhere between 4 and 11 years. That's a long time, even if it's 4 years, that somebody's trying to track you down with a group. The king, the most powerful man in the country, is hunting you to want to kill you. That's what Saul was doing for David. And Mephibosheth is Saul's grandson. The relevance is that, as we know, I come from the UK and we have a royal family, right? So when the queen dies, her son becomes king or grandson. That's why we watch the royal family, right? Prince George and all that kind of stuff. He's in line to the throne. So Mephibosheth is somewhere in line to the throne of Israel as Saul's grandson. But Saul and Jonathan get killed. So Saul dies. It should really be Jonathan, but Jonathan also dies. But as we know the story, God had told David, you're actually going to be king. So this is a switch from what normally should happen because David's not in Saul's family. So David is in line now. He finds out Saul and Jonathan are dead. He's in line to the throne. And in much of history, whenever a king would die, what happens is all-out war starts. Because people who want the throne are going to go kill the guys that are in line. Or the people who aren't in line are going to go kill the pretenders. So in other words, normally David would be the guy that really would be hunted. Well, let's get rid of him. Because Mephibosheth should be in line to the throne. But of course, people knew that God had picked David. So Mephibosheth now has a problem. And what happens is that Mephibosheth's maid picks him up. He's a little boy at the time. Picks him up and goes running with him. All the family are fleeing out of town. And she drops him and breaks his legs. And he lived, on account of that, he lived the rest of his life as a cripple. I've been to Africa. Any of you guys ever been to Africa or India, anywhere like that? I've seen people with limbs all distorted and stuff. And that's usually when they break something. Like for us, we've got medical care that we take for granted. You can get fixed up. Some of these countries, and especially in these times, you break a limb, that's it. You know, you have to deal with that the rest of your life. That's Mephibosheth. This crippled boy and his maid takes him with all these other guys and they go and live in a place called Lodibar. That's relevant. I'm going to come back to it in a little while. Well, here's the contrast I want to take. This is the story, the backdrop of Mephibosheth going into a life of hiding. Far away because he assumes that David's going to kill him. Because he's in Saul's family. And this is the question I want you to think about today. He begins a life in hiding, and many of us live our lives in hiding. But the scripture talks also about being hidden. So the title of today's sermon is, Are You Hiding or Are You Hidden? Here's a scripture from the New Testament. It says, If then you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things that are above, not on the things that are on earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. So now I want you to think, and I'm going to raise a few questions for you to think about as we go through this message today. Are you living hidden or are you hiding? Are you hiding yourself away from the world, away from people? Are you hiding away from what you're afraid of? Are you living in a mentality of self-preservation or one of prospering in the life that Jesus rose from the dead to give you? Are you living a life of fear about what the devil can do to you more than in faith in what God has already done for you and is doing for you and wants to do for you? That would be the difference between hiding or being hidden. So let's pick up the story. Let me read from 2 Samuel chapter 9. David asked, Is there anyone still left of the house of Saul to whom I can show kindness for Jonathan's sake? Now there was a servant of Saul's household named Ziba. They called him to appear before David, and the king said to him, Are you Ziba? Your servant, he replied. The king asked, Is there no one still left of the house of Saul to whom I can show kindness? Ziba answered the king, There's still a son of Jonathan. He's crippled in both feet. Where is he? The king asked. Ziba answered, He's at the house of Machir, son of Amiel, in Lodibar. He's away in this other place. So King David had him brought from Lodibar, from the house of Machir, son of Amiel. When Mephibosheth, son of Jonathan, the son of Saul, this is relevant why it says this, came to David, he bowed down to pay him honor. He thinks he's going to get killed. David said, Mephibosheth, your servant, he replied. Don't be afraid, David said to him, for I will surely show you kindness for the sake of your father, Jonathan. I will restore to you the land that belonged to your grandfather, Saul, and you will always eat at my table. Mephibosheth bowed down and said, What is your servant that you should notice a dead dog like me? Then the king summoned Ziba, Saul's servant, and said to him, I've given your master's grandson everything that belonged to Saul and his family. You and your sons and your servants are to farm the land for him. Remember, he's crippled. He can't work the land. And bring the crops so that your master's grandson may be provided for. And Mephibosheth, grandson of your master, will always eat at my table. Now Ziba had 15 sons and 20 servants. He just got a staff of 35 people. Then Ziba said to the king, Your servant will do whatever my lord the king commands his servant to do. So Mephibosheth ate at David's table like one of the king's sons. Mephibosheth had a young son named Micah, and all the members of Ziba's household were servants of Mephibosheth. And Mephibosheth lived in Jerusalem because he always ate at the king's table, and he was crippled in both feet. I want to describe, before I talk more about this guy, I want to describe what hiding looks like, just so that we're on the same page. I used this message recently, and somebody said to me, when you started talking, I was thinking, I don't hide. And then as we went a little bit through it, he was like, oh, wait, yes, I do. So let's talk about what hiding looks like. You and I as human beings have been trained how to hide very well. Because our earliest ancestors, Adam and Eve, they started it. They were your personal trainer and my personal trainer on how to hide. Here's what happened. We know the story in the book of Genesis, right, where God tells them, you can eat from anything in the garden except this one tree right here. So they eat from it. And it says that before that, that they walked in the garden and they were naked and they knew no shame. As soon as they ate from that tree, what did they do? They covered themselves. They made coverings for themselves and they went and hid. They hid from each other and they hid from God. And when God comes to Adam and says, Where are you? He said, I was naked, so I hid. And God said, Who told you that you were naked? How do you know that? Immediately, what happened was Adam and Eve became aware of the very thing, the main reason why you and I hide is because of shame. It says that they were naked before sin. They were naked and they knew no shame. There was a purity in them. When sin came in, they were very quickly aware of the shame they had, and they withdrew from each other and hid themselves, and they withdrew and hid from God. The worst two things that we can do. Why would we hide? Hiding comes from feeling vulnerable. It comes from feeling exposed. I'm going to ask you a question. You don't have to raise your hand to this. It's a weird question that some people have had dreams, and I've had this dream of being left somewhere totally naked. Right? Don't raise your hand if you've ever had that dream. I asked that question a while back where people were looking at me like, you're a weirdo. You know, they obviously never had that dream, but some of us have had that dream. The feeling of being completely exposed somewhere in public, I'd be like, oh golly, that'd be the worst thing that could ever happen to me. That's why we hide. The feeling of vulnerability, the feeling of being really seen makes us afraid. In fact, you become the only person you can trust in, and that's what we were trained to do by Adam and Eve. You are the only person that can trust you, and you have to hide from everyone else. You've got to keep yourself, at least to some degree or another, a little bit separated from everyone else, a little bit separated from God. They had a shameless connection, which they lost, and they pulled away from the Lord and from each other. I'm going to give you a definition for shame. Shame, because it's our primary motivation to hide. Shame is the feeling of being innately flawed. That there is something innately wrong with me. Or you're thinking there's something innately wrong with yourself. That somehow inside me, something about who I am, something about my identity, I feel that I'm just bad. And that feeling is what makes us feel like we either don't belong, we're never allowed to belong, we can never be included, we can never really be blessed or never really be favored. Yes, God loves me, but I can't have everything. I can't have it like you have it. And so you hide and keep yourself away. I'll give you a personal example from my own life. Years ago, I went through a divorce, and it was a difficult time, very difficult time. And I was a missionary at the time. And I could feel the failure in my life, the pressure that it put on me. And all I wanted to do was run away from everyone I knew. So I went back to Scotland. I mean, my island where I come from is in the North Sea. It's 60 degrees north. It's you can hide up there, let me tell you. It's a long way. Nobody wants to go there looking for you. I'll show you that. Not in the wintertime, anyway. So I go there thinking I'm going to go there because I'll be with my family. My brothers are there. My parents are there. They'll comfort me. I was feeling sorry for myself. Anyone ever felt sorry for themselves? Everybody raise your hand. We've all felt sorry for ourselves, and it feels awesome at the time, doesn't it? Like, and this is what trusting yourself is. Self-pity is a killer. Shame will motivate self-pity. And it tells you this, you're the only one that really loves you. You're the only one that you can really trust. They all just don't understand. Oh, poor Jim. As they would say in Spanish, pobrecito. Like a little poor guy. Feeling sorry for yourself. And that's what I was doing, thinking that it was going to help me. And that was motivated by shame. And then I had a friend from Houston email me. Can you believe this? They email me. God speaks through people in so many different ways. And in this email, she said, I've been praying for you. And right now, your shame is more toxic to you even than sin. And I thought, she needs to read the Bible. You know, what kind of theology is that? How could anything be worse than sin? Well, the scripture, if you read through the New Testament, talks quite a bit about shame and sin. Shame is what can still linger and hang over you even after your sin has been forgiven. There were two goats that used to be sacrificed on the Day of Atonement. One was for sin, and the other one, the priests would lay their hands on it and send it out into the desert. It was called a scapegoat. We've all heard that term, right? That was them laying the shame on it and sending it away. And many of us have known that Jesus has forgiven us from our sin. We've done some terrible things, some of us, and we look back at it and we're so glad that we're not going to hell for it, but yet we're still living out of our lives, carrying the burden and the cloak of shame that says, yeah, but there's still something in you that's innately bad, and you're always going to walk with a limp and be a bit of a spiritual cripple. And so you hide, keep things to yourself, pity yourself, only trust in yourself, hiding away from others and hiding away from God. Hiding is a frame of mind. It's an attitude. It's a choice of what you want to believe and what you want to think about and how you're going to walk that out. I'm going to give you some examples of what hiding looks like. Hiding looks like being afraid a lot about all sorts of things. Fear is a place to hide. It feels so comfortable to just be afraid about everything. That's another thing like self-pity. I'm going to justify my own fear for how the world's all going bad. And I'm going to hide in it. I'm going to cover myself up with it, separate myself from all those naive, happy, optimistic, faith-filled people. I'm going to be afraid, and I'm going to justify it. Isolation comes from that. What did Adam and Eve do? Isolated from each other, isolated from God. Not the same as solitude. Jesus would go to solitary places to pray. That's purposeful, where you're going to meet God. You expect to meet him and you go to meet him. Isolation is the opposite, where you run away from God and you hide from him. Exclusivity. Lack of authentic relationships. And I'm not talking about, well, I'm still pals with my, buddy from kindergarten 40 years later. I think that's great, by the way. I have friends from when I was a kid. I think it's great. But authentic relationships is this. Where you have disagreement. A lot of us have no sound of disagreement in our lives. No one who disagrees with us. Only people we've got around us are the people just like us that agree with us. Facebook's great for that. Put stuff on there all the time just to get everybody to like and say, I agree with you. And delete everybody that doesn't agree with me. There is a place to get rid of people from your Facebook. But my point is that this is some of what it looks like to hide. There's no one in our lives that disagrees. Because either we don't let them or we've withdrawn from them because they're different. An authentic relationship and friendship is one where there's invitation, where there's honesty, where there's vulnerability for you to be seen that you might be wrong. You might be wrong. What are you going to do with that? Oh, it feels horrible to be wrong, so I'm just going to hide from the people who are right. I'm going to hide from the people who are different. I'm going to hide from the people who will challenge me. And they have that on Facebook too, don't they, where you get poked? I hate that, when my wife does it to me, like pokes me in the ribs because I'm ticklish. It's not an excuse, by the way, to poke me in the ribs later. I hate that feeling. God will do that, and he'll use people to do it. To say, I think you're in hiding. Jab. And it might come through Facebook. It might come through church. It might come through a sermon like this. Where God's saying, you're hiding. You're hiding. You're separating yourself. You don't let anyone disagree. You don't have anyone around you that's different from you. You don't go anywhere where it makes you feel a little uncomfortable. Because you just want to hide and protect yourself in the bushes. Like Adam, but the worst part of it is that you're disconnected from God. That's why hiding is not a thing of trust. It's a thing of fear. It's not a thing of faith to hide. It's a thing of fear. I used to work with this guy. And this is where I think the fear comes from. I used to work with this guy, and he was not a Christian. And, we worked in construction, so there's all day long, you're messing with each other and stuff like that. And if I would do something, to him, like play a trick, practical joke on him or something like that, he used this phrase. He would say, God will get you for that. God will get you for that. He was just joking, But a lot of us live with this mentality, the same way that Adam and Eve did when they went and hid, which is God is going to get me. Meaning he's going to judge me. He's going to really come down hard on me. And that's where fear comes from. I know this because in the book of 1 John, it says, perfect love casts out fear. And fear has to do with punishment. When we think in the back of our mind that God is going to punish us, we're afraid. And that means we haven't yet known the perfect love of God for us, that he's not going to punish you. He's not looking to punish you, and he's not looking to get you. That's what hiding looks like. So I want to talk about, where do we hide? This place called Lodibar, where Mephibosheth went. Mephibosheth went to this place called Lodibar. I'm going to describe what that means in a moment. But in our attitude, in our inner life, in our spiritual life, and in our relationships, hiding takes us to dark places. Dark, lonely, isolated, horrible places that only deepen our fear and they deepen our perspective of harm. that God is on the prowl to harm us, that he's trying to judge you. And if you think about all the way from Joshua, I mean, it's before Joshua, but to me, I can see in the first chapter of Joshua, God is saying to him, going into the promised land, don't be afraid. Be courageous. Be strong and courageous. Don't be afraid. Meditate on my word and don't be afraid. He keeps saying it. And Jesus is saying it to the disciples all the time. Don't be afraid. In this world, you will have trouble. Don't be afraid. People are going to hate you like they hated me. Don't be afraid. All the time he's saying it. My peace I leave with you. I do not give as the world gives. Don't be afraid. Fear is that God's going to get us. He's going to punish us. Listen to what Jesus says here from this scripture in John's gospel. I have come into the world as light. Before I continue, I just want to say this. You might think, well, this is obvious. I'm a Christian. Lots of Christians are living fearing that God is looking to punish them and judge them. And it makes you hide. Hide away from God, the intimacy that God wants with you. But get what Jesus is saying here. I've come into the world as light so that whoever believes in me may not remain in darkness, a hiding place. If anyone hears my word, now this is amazing to me. If anyone hears my word and does not keep them, I do not judge him. We would think, and we live a lot of our lives, and a lot of what comes out of us in the church is that the only people that God's not judging are those who are living righteous. And Jesus just said, even those who do not keep my words, I do not judge them. And he clarifies it. He goes on to say, for I did not come to judge the world, but to save the world. Even when you're making a mess, even when you're hiding and you've been hiding for years, even when your life is toxic because of sin and you've been deliberately rebellious and running away from God, Jesus is saying, I'm not judging you. I did not come to judge you. There is a day coming. He's coming to return to bring judgment. But in this season, in this time, Paul puts it like this. Now is the day of salvation. Now is the time of God's favor upon you. Even when you don't keep his word, he's reaching out with love towards you to come out of your hiding place and have relationship with him. This is the heart of God for you and for me. And Lodibar is totally the contrary. This is what Lodibar actually means in the original language. It means no pasture or a place of naught. And in one word, you can put it like this. It means nothing. Nothing. Nothing grows there. There's nothing good there. There's nothing hopeful about this place. There's no future with it. There's nothing there that's good for you. It's just a place of nothing. And that's what hiding is. It is a place of nothing. And I'm talking about our spiritual life, our inner life. And it does show up in our relationships. If you don't have friendships and you don't have close relationships and you don't have a sense of fruit in your life, it's showing up because of what's happening on the inside. There's a really great scripture in one of John's epistles where he says that, and you'll know this scripture, anyone who says that he loves God but hates his brother is a liar, right? That's pretty harsh, right? Like straight to it. And it goes on to say, so anyone who says he loves God but does not love his brother doesn't love God, basically, I'm paraphrasing. And what that means is, if you say you love God, it shows up in the way you treat your brothers. You love them. That doesn't mean that you're all yippee-yay about everybody all the time. But you don't get, what he's saying is this, Jim Sim paraphrase, you don't get to say you love God and you hate everybody. You don't get to say that because you don't love God. If you love God and you're in the love of God, there will be love that will come out of you. Likewise, if you're out of hiding, you have open relationships. You have open friendships. You have fruit that's growing. If you're not hiding in Lodibar, you don't have barren, pastureless, nothing lives. You have lives that show up fruit with good relationships, with increase. And it might be tiny incremental increases, which we've got to get better at celebrating, by the way. We're not all going to turn it into Billy Graham tomorrow. But every little incremental increase that you get is a victory. That's growth. That's fruit. That's what the kingdom of God is about. We've got to celebrate that stuff. But if we don't have that, maybe it's because we're in hiding. And like Mephibosheth, remember, he was an heir to the throne. He came from a regal family. And when you're in Christ, you are part of a regal family. But you might be hiding in some dump somewhere with nothing growing, with nothing increasing and nothing happening. Maybe it's because you hid yourself away. Let me ask you these questions. Ask to yourself, listen to the Holy Spirit in this moment. Are you living in Lodibar? Do you feel like you're in a place of nothing? Pastureless, there's no growth happening. Do you feel cut off, disconnected from where God really intends for you to be? This was never God's intention for Mephibosheth. Do you feel like you're apart from the people that you really ought to be with? Do you feel afraid of the future and what bad may come? Do you feel afraid of it? Now, be honest with yourself. This is a good one to park here at this moment, I think. Do you feel afraid of the future and what may come? That will send you into hiding. That's exactly what Mephibosheth did. Let me explain, because I know that you could say, well, Jim, good for that's easy for you to say. You know, and we do this a lot, right, when someone does what I'm doing right now. Well, that's easy for you to say. You're not in my shoes. You're not living my experience. There are two comparisons I want to make here. You could list to me a bunch of facts, or I could list them to you. A bunch of facts about your circumstances, why somehow it's different for you, that you do need to be in Lodibar, because the devil will try to convince you of that. And the facts and the truth are not the same. You can line up all the facts, but God's truth is always bigger and greater and from a perspective higher than the facts. I'm going to explain. Let's go through some of Mephibosheth's facts. Let's say I was preaching this message to Mephibosheth and saying, you don't need to be in Lodibar. You've got a regal, princely life that you were called to. And you're down here squandering it, hiding it in fear, and God's got more for you. And he could say, oh, well, Jim, put yourself in his shoes. His future was taken out of his own hands by his maid. Anyone ever felt like, well, so-and-so did such-and-such to me, or I grew up in such-and-such a home, and that's why I am where I am right now? Your future was taken out of your hands. I never got to go to the school I wanted to. I had kids too young. I got married too young. I did this or I went there. My parents moved here and I hated it. We've all got facts that we can line up. I have them. You have them. You can line up these facts to tell me, or worse, to tell God why you need to be in hiding, why your life is pastureless, and justify it. Mephibosheth has the same story. My future was taken out of my hands by my maid. She dropped me and crippled me. I couldn't even do manual labor, which was for most people they had to do in those times. There was no sitting at a desk. I can't even take care of myself. He was suffering from an unfortunate disablement. Anyone ever felt disabled by someone else's actions? And you can feel really empowered to feel mad about it, afraid of the future about it, blame someone else about it, righteously. Because you're suffering an unfortunate disablement, and it's real. It was real for this guy. Judgment. He could say, easy for you to say, do you understand that when my father Jonathan died, my uncle, because this is in the scriptures, his uncle Ish-bosheth was actually next in line before him. David had a couple of guys that went and killed Ish-bosheth, murdered him. So he could say, I'm down here hiding because David's guys went and killed my uncle. They were coming for me next. He has a historical precedent. And you could line that up as facts and say, yeah, well, I can go all the way back to here. And this happened, and that happened, and then this. And you might have a historical precedent to line up the facts as to why life might be pastureless. He was displaced by politics. There's all sorts of facts that Mephibosheth could line up. But what he did not know was that his dad had a covenant that was hidden. He's in hiding, and unbeknownst to him, there is a hidden covenant. And this covenant, let me read it to you. This is David talking to him. Don't be afraid, David said. I will surely show kindness to you for the sake of your father Jonathan. Those words tell him, I had a covenant, an agreement with your dad that I would take care of you. And now, he didn't know about that. Mephibosheth had no idea, obviously. And then he says, David, I will restore to you all the land that belonged to your grandfather Saul, and you will always eat at my table. So I listed the facts. Now here's the truths. Here's the truths for Mephibosheth. The king, the most powerful man in the world at that time, arguably, but certainly in that country, has now established his kingdom. He comes looking for Mephibosheth. David comes looking to find him, to rescue him. Not just once, but twice. Later in Mephibosheth's life, some people wanted to execute judgment on a covenant that Saul had broken. And David gave over several of his family members to be executed. And he said, but not Mephibosheth. He gets to survive. The king came for him twice. Is this ringing any bells yet? Jesus, Harry said, I did not come to judge, I came to save the world. And then it says that he's coming back again, a second time, for us who are waiting for him to inherit salvation. I'm going to read that scripture later. Mephibosheth got the best of the best. He was put into the most honored family in the whole country. David said, you get to sit at the table with my sons. You become like one of my sons. And he said, you'll always sit at my table. He gets all the land that his grandfather Saul owned that had been lost. David said, right, I'm going to give you all that land back. Well, yeah, but I'm crippled. I can't work it. Oh, okay, then, hey, you, whatever your name is, Ziba, you and all your sons and servants, you're now working for him. 35 staff. This is what Jesus does for you and for me. Ever remember that scripture where it says that the angels are sent as ministering spirits to the saints? Jesus comes looking for you and looking for me to save us, to restore to us things that we've had lost, things that we've been hiding away from receiving. And he adds angels to it as well. And he just keeps adding stuff after stuff. He says, you will never be sent away from my table ever. That's what David said. And that's what Jesus says to me and you. You'll never be sent away ever. He went from exile to becoming a son, which is what you and I have found when we put our life in Christ. You go from being in exile in a dump of pastureless, nothing places to being at his table where you never have to leave. He's never going to kick you out. And he's adding stuff upon stuff upon stuff to want to bless you. This grace was given me. This is Apostle Paul talking. This grace was given me to preach to the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ and to make plain to everyone the administration of this mystery, get this, which for ages past was kept hidden in God who created all things. His intent was that now, through the church, the manifold wisdom of God should be made known. This covenant is not hidden anymore. It should be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly realms according to his eternal purpose, which he accomplished in Christ Jesus. In him and through faith in him, we may approach God with freedom and confidence. You do not have to hide any part of your life. You don't have to hide any sin that's ever happened in your life. You don't have to hide anything that you're afraid of or worried about, or where you've been failing, because you can approach God with freedom and confidence because a covenant that was hidden for a long time has now been revealed where the king comes for you to be at his table and to fellowship with him. Here's your facts and here's your truths. What I'm going to do is I'm going to parallel us with Mephibosheth, and I'm going to begin to go here and then I'm going to conclude. And I'm going to parallel Mephibosheth's truths and facts with your truths and facts. You have your own facts. I don't know them. You have even today sitting here thinking, well, this all sounds too good to be true, that I could be at the Lord's table. There is parts of my life I need to keep tucked away because I'm so ashamed of it. And you might line those up, and here's the truths. The mystery that has been kept hidden for ages and generations is now disclosed to the saints. To them, God has chosen to make known among the Gentiles the glorious riches of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Just like the king came for Mephibosheth, Jesus the king came for you. Luke 19:10 says that the Son of Man came to seek and to save that which was lost. He comes not just once, but twice. So Christ was sacrificed once to take away the sins of many people, and he will appear a second time. Not to bear sin, but to bring salvation to those who are waiting for him. That's you and me. Jesus coming back for us again because we're waiting for him to bring us the wholeness of our salvation. You and I, just like Mephibosheth, we get the best of the best brought into an honored family and get to become children that sit at his table. Romans 8:32, he who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, also graciously give us all things? That's the same as Mephibosheth getting to the table and all the land back and all the servants to work the land and didn't ever have to leave. That's what this is. Then he gets a lost family inheritance. This is what the scripture says about you. If we are children, then we are heirs, heirs of God, and co-heirs with Christ. Here's a psalm for you. I love this psalm. The boundary lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Surely I have a delightful inheritance. This is your promise, not a hiding place. A boundary lines are put around you of pleasant places for you to walk with the Lord out of hiding. Open, free, with confidence you can approach him. And the last one is this, from exile to a son. Once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior. But now he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight, without blemish, and free from accusation. I'm going to end here pretty much where I started, and that's to say this. Without blemish and free from accusation, if you're in hiding, it's because you're afraid or you're aware of your shame. And this is teaching us that Jesus has come to lift the shame, to take it away, and there is no accusation. God is not looking to get you. God is not looking to harm you. He's inviting you today to pull up a chair to his table and to enjoy his presence. And that hiding that's in your heart will keep you in a pastureless, barren place. And it might not be your whole life. It's probably not. There's perhaps today a place in your life that you've struggled with for a long time and you're thinking, I just never seem to get anything growing here. It could be your money, it could be your marriage, it could be with your kids, it could be with your parents, it could be at your job. You just say, I'm just always in this pastureless place. Maybe you've put it into hiding. Maybe you've just tucked it away somewhere and thought, I'm just gonna have to deal with it, live with it. I don't like this when people use this scripture and misplace it. Well, this is my thorn in the flesh. No, the devil wants to convince you of that stuff so you stay barren. Look at what I've just listed here in the scripture, how Jesus is calling you out of it, out of barrenness, out of pastureless places, how much he's done and invested for your life to be fruitful, to overcome, and to have victory. One little anecdote to close up. There's a friend of mine in Panama was telling me a story how a lady he knew who was a Christian had been witnessing to her brother, I think it was, and the guy had lived quite a reprobate lifestyle, let's say. And he felt so ashamed of himself that God could never accept him. And she kept witnessing to him. And eventually he said, okay, I'll tell you what then. If God really speaks to you, I want to know that God is really talking to you. And what I want you to do is I want you to pray about a sin I committed X amount of years ago. It was really bad. And I want you, because I think God can never forgive me, I want you to go pray about it and tell me what God tells you. Right, a little test. She said, all right. So she prayed about it. I don't remember how long, a week, two, whatever. But she comes back. They renew the conversation. And it goes something like this. So he asks, what did God tell you? She said, well, I did ask him about that sin. And he said, he doesn't remember it. That's just like God. Because he takes our shame away. He takes our sin and our shame away. If then you have, and that's what it is to be hidden. That's what it is to live a life hidden with Christ in God. When you've entrusted it all to him, let him do with it what he wants to do. Let him put it where he wants to put it. And he says he nailed it to the cross, scorning its shame, and defeated all the powers of hell that are against us. If then you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things that are above, not on the things that are on the earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. And when Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. Three things I want you to pray, if you would just bow your heads with me for a moment and close your eyes. I want you to pray these three things, or think about these three things. Just present it to the Holy Spirit where you are. If you've been in hiding in any place in your life, just talk to the Lord about it right now and come out of hiding. Just come out. I said, I don't want to hide it anymore. I don't want this part of my life or any part of me to be in hiding, disconnected from you. He sees it anyway. Talk to him about that and give it to him so that you can grow and come out of pastureless places. And the metaphor of pulling up a chair, this is the second thing. Picture yourself pulling up a chair alongside Jesus at the table. And just to enjoy his protection and his provision, the security of him next to you. That you're a brother in the family of God, a sister in the family of God. But it doesn't get any better than that honored position. However you do that in your own mind's eye, just pull up a chair next to Jesus and this is where I want to be, with you. And the last thing, I want you to make a bold statement to the Lord and repeat what he would say to you, and it's this. There's nothing to fear. There's nothing to fear. He's not coming to punish you. He's not looking for how to punish you. Jesus said, I have overcome the world. Have faith in me. Decide today, I have faith in Jesus. I'm going to have faith in you and what you've done. There is nothing to fear. Jesus says that no one can snatch us from his hand, and that those that the Father has given him will never perish. That's your promise. Like Mephibosheth, he said, you'll always be at my table. That's what Jesus says for you. You're always at his table. Lord, thank you for the promises of your word. Thank you for all that you've accomplished through the cross and through your resurrection. And we thank you that we can celebrate fullness of life with you, that we don't have to live any part of our lives hidden. And so we come to you today with open hearts, with open lives. Help us to continue to grow. We come out and leave behind barren places, pastureless places in our lives. Help us where we need relationships to teach us how to be vulnerable with you, to teach us how to trust you with those difficult spots, with those dark spots, with those challenging things. Help us to do that, Lord, trusting you to heal us and free us and prosper us in every part of our lives. Thank you that you want us to be fruitful and for all you've done to make it that way. In Jesus' name, everybody said, amen. Amen.